ASU researchers are looking at choline as a factor in helping reduce the risk of Alzheimer's disease. And tonight, as part of our monthly AARP sponsors segment that highlights issues important to older adults in Arizona, we look at the promising results involving choline. Ramón Velazquez is a neuroscientist at ASU's Neurodegenerative Neurodegenerative Disease Research Center. You guys and your titles, I tell you, good to have you here.
Good to have you too. It's a mouthful, yes.
It is a mouthful. Maybe I need some more choline. What is choline?
That's a great question. First of all, thank you for having me. So choline is an organic compound that's produced endogenously by our body, right? So our body, mammalian species, that means animals, other forms of animals, including humans, we can produce it. However, it's been noted based on multiple years of research that the amount you make within your body is not enough. So you need to actually consume it in your diet. You need dietary choline.
Yeah. Okay, dietary choline. Mm-hmm. What do we need to eat more of?
So what do you need to eat more of? It depends on what type of diet you're typically attuned to, right? So we know that there's individuals that are plant-based eaters. Some do eat animal products, some don't. The highest concentration of choline you will find in eggs, also in poultry, as well as in fish products like salmon, leafy greens, and also beans.
Interesting. I saw broccoli listed.
Broccoli as well, leafy green.
Okay.
Yes.
Is that enough? If I start eating broccoli every other day and salmon on the other day, is that going to be enough?
It depends, right? So what you need to do and what really we're trying to advocate here is there needs to be awareness, right? Most Americans are not reaching the recommendations that are required by the Institute of Medicine to get adequate choline, right? And there's actually numbers on this, right? So adult women require 425 milligrams of choline a day. Men require 550 milligrams of choline a day. Most Americans are not getting enough.
Interesting. All right. Is supplements, are they okay?
Supplements are available. So these are particularly important for plant-based eaters and for those in general that don't want to consume a lot of animal products because the animal products do have a higher amount of choline and they are available.
Okay. Well, can you have too much choline?
So in order to reach the amount that's considered toxic amounts of choline, you need to consume 6.5 times the recommended daily amount, which is about 3.5 grams. That's a lot of choline. The side effects of having too much choline include low blood pressure and you also produce a fishy odor smell because of the metabolite, but those are the side effects. But it's very difficult to reach that amount.
The supplements, can you take a pill? Should you take a powder? What do you look for in these supplements?
So the supplements that are available in regards to choline are going to be in pill forms. And there's various different types, right? So there's choline chloride. That is the most common form that's available. It gets metabolized by your liver and then is circulating through your bloodstream and does have the ability to get up into your brain. There's also another form known as alpha GPC. It's a type of choline that is easier to get up into your actual brain. So we recommend alpha GPC as one of the most effective forms.
You mentioned gets up into your brain. Uh-huh. How does it get up into your brain?
So the way it does that is by using ultimately our vasculature, right? Circulating throughout your blood, right? So if choline is processed by your stomach and then it makes its way into digestive tracts, it can be absorbed into your brain. In order to do that, there's actually transporters in what's called the blood-brain barrier, which protects from things that you don't want to get into your brain and getting in, and then choline is allowed to transport into the brain.
Wow, how interesting. And once it gets into your brain, does it affect neurotransmitters? Mm-hmm. What does it affect?
That is a great question, and that's what we've been finding, right? So when these recommendations were first established in 1998, the scientific field believed that it was predominantly related to fat metabolism in your liver. What we have found now is that it's important in creating chemicals in your brain that are important for learning and memory, higher order cognition. It also allows for building cell membranes, which are going to protect what goes in and out of your cells, and overall going to enhance cognitive function.
And I know from your research that if you take the choline and you get enough choline and you exercise, which seems like a panacea these days for everything, you're on a pretty good track.
Yes, that's actually, I'm glad you brought this up. I'm actually heading to a workout class after this, right? And what we have done in that regard, and there's a lot of research around this, is that combining lifestyle factors that are important that are going to allow for reduction in a lot of metabolic dysfunction. So metabolic dysfunction, for example, includes disorders like diabetes, high blood pressure, things of that sort. Those are risk factors for disorders like Alzheimer's disease. If you can reduce those by one, exercising, and two, there is evidence that choline can actually buffer or reduce those aspects, the probability of having prevalence for Alzheimer's disease goes down drastically.
Okay, are they on separate tracks or do they kind of work together? Hard to know. I mean, do we know that?
So do we know whether there's combined effects if you combine both? The literature there is a little thin. We are actually working on some of this with colleagues at ASU currently, but we know that the processes that they affect are similar, right? So if you exercise, you're gonna affect cardiovascular function that's gonna promote health. And if you take choline, it actually has the ability to regulate, for example, glucose levels, which is important because you don't want to progress to diabetes, risk factor for Alzheimer's.
Interesting. Okay, how do you know you're not getting enough choline?
See, that is the number one question that we always get. There's no test that you can go and routinely get.
No blood test even?
Right. There is a blood test, but you have to request it, right? So you can go to your doctor and say, can I measure the amount of choline levels that I have? The way that we get around that is by doing dietary questionnaires. We can actually give you a dietary questionnaire, and we can estimate the amount of choline that you're actually consuming, right? But most Americans, one, do not know what choline is, right? Usually when I give seminars, I ask, who knows what choline is? About 10% of individuals raise their hand. They know what it is. 90% of Americans are deficient in choline. That means they're not getting the recommended daily intake amount that they need.
If 90% of Americans are deficient, and we've seen just this increase in Alzheimer's, which obviously has something to do with lifespans and increasing lifespans, I mean, that alone suggests something's going on.
Yeah, I think what this suggests is that choline is a component that we need to be attuned to in order to try to deter from disorders like Alzheimer's disease. I think once again, going back to the combination of factors, right? It's not just choline, it's a combination such as, do you get enough exercise? Are you cognitively engaged, right? We were just having conversations about how do crossword puzzles actually activate areas of your brain that can actually promote what's called cognitive resilience that causes a buffer. So when a disease like Alzheimer's disease hits, your neurons, which are the cells in your brain that produce our behaviors, can kind of remove those so they don't actually overtake your behaviors.
This is really interesting because, choline, I'm thinking just talking chlorine, you're talking about my swimming pool here,
right?
And most people just haven't heard about it,
yeah.
And it's so important. Again, Ramón Velazquez, great information.
Thank you so
good
much.
Good to have you here, and good to see you again.
Always a pleasure. Thank you
All
so
right.
much.
All right, thank you.